Lepo pozdravljeni na znanstvenih večerih Univerze v Novi Gorici. So good evening and I welcome you to the scientific evenings of University of Nova Gorica. And tonight it's my great pleasure to present you today's speaker, Dr. Wolfgang Grube from DESI, so German, largest German synchrotron radiation facility in Hamburg. His work is connected with synchrotron radiation, I think, all his career. He did, as a matter of fact, he did his PhD in solid state physics and was at postdoc position at IBM Watson Research Center in United States. But after that, from 1988-9, he's at DESI as a beamline manager of different beamlines, and from 96 on, also coordinator of beamlines, and especially in the last period, from 2003, he's in charge of scientific user operation at two facilities, first at DORIS, this is the old machine, and now Petra 3 Photon Science Group, which is a new machine constructed rather recently. Machine for synchrotron radiation production. So his main scientific interest, the main field, is study of electronic structure in solids by photoelectron spectroscopy, and he published more than 150 publications in this field. But today I invite him to give us a talk, a bit broader talk about use of these bright sources of X-rays and UV synchrotron radiation sources with nice examples of the use which, for which synchrotron radiation is, of course, necessary. So please, I give you the table.
Okay. Yes, Doc, thank you very much for this nice introduction. So it's good to be back in the area. I just looked it up this morning. So I was here 11 years ago when I visited you in Nova Gorica. And now I'm back. This is really nice. Even the weather is nice, much nicer than in Hamburg. So I really appreciate that. Well organized. And I will use the opportunity to tell you a little bit what we can do with brilliant X-rays to explore properties of the microcosm. And coming back to what you said in your introduction, I will tell you nothing about my special field. So no electronic structure, no electron spectroscopy, but I will cover different things which are also related to X-rays. So let me start by reminding you of the, at least for inorganic materials, building blocks of matter. And let's start with crystals. And if you go down in the length scale here, starting from about a decimeter, then you are at the molecular scale, this is a nanometer here. Then we are at atoms, a factor of 10 less, this is an angstrom. And then there are particles which comprise the nucleus. But in this presentation, I will only be concerned with this part, although I should mention that the laboratory where I come from, they are also doing high energy physics, so they are also looking at this part, but this will not be the case here. So let's look at the length scale of a few centimeters where crystals are made of. And there are typical examples I've shown here of crystals which have a different shape, but they also have one thing in common, they are all transparent. And the reason is that they are all composed of different elements here, but also the structure is different. And the structure, if you look at that in detail, can be quite different. You see the elements here in salt, for example, sodium and chloride. Here's a more complex structure, which is sugar, diamond, more simple, cubic, and this is a rock salt, silicon dioxide structure. So this is all very different on a microscopic scale, and X-rays are an excellent probe to get the structure of these materials, and we will come back to that. So as you know, our most direct probe to interact with materials is by looking at them. So light is sort of the major probe to study properties of materials, and usually we would use a microscope to zoom in into materials to increase the magnification, but this cannot be done indefinitely. So there is a limit. And this limit is connected to the wavelength of the light, which we are using. And this was first nicely described by Ernst Abbe in Jena, end of the 19th century. And he told us that the smallest separation of two lines, which can distinctively be viewed by an optical microscope, is given by this equation here. So if you're not familiar with mathematics, never mind the sine alpha. Sine alpha is something between 0 and 1. So the smallest distance you can get here is when you make this one close to 1, which means that lambda is sort of determining the smallest distance of or structure of materials that you can resolve. And looking at the spectrum of wavelengths that you have at your disposal, this is a wide range which we have in nature, starting from radio waves to gamma rays. And since we want to explore the microcosm, we are somewhere around here where molecules and atoms are. And this is the wavelength range which corresponds to X-rays. So whenever you want to explore properties at the microcosmic or nanoscale range, we would have to use X-rays. So these are the wavelengths, and in physics, we synonymously also talk about energies, where wavelengths can be translated into energies, and this is 10 kilovolts. Electron volts, and electron volts corresponds to the energy an electron gets when it's accelerated by 1 volt. So 10 kilovolts and about an angstrom of wavelengths is the same quantity to measure energy of an X-ray. So looking back a little bit on how X-rays were discovered, and most of you probably know that Wilhelm Röntgen discovered X-rays. That's why they got their name, at least in German. It's called Röntgenstrahlung. Usually in other countries, they refer to as X-rays. And he discovered X-rays in 1895. And for this, he got the first Nobel Prize in 1901. This doesn't mean that he got another one, but he actually got the first Nobel Prize ever. And this is a picture of his lab back in the University of Würzburg. And how are X-rays generated? They are generated by accelerating a beam of electrons to a very high energy, 40 to 80 kiloelectron volts. Here is the unit again, which I just mentioned. And they impinge on a solid target, and then rays are emitted. And Röntgen discovered that these rays have very high penetration depth. And this can be seen by the very first picture that he took of his wife shortly after he discovered the rays in early December. This was late December, shortly before Christmas. And apparently, the hand is sort of transparent except for the bone structure, because that bone structure is more dense. So the contrast that you see when you shine with X-rays to materials is caused, of course, by the density of the material the X-rays have to penetrate. And this is what's giving the contrast here. And as I said, the production is through an X-ray tube here. Electrons impinge on the target. And what happens is that the electrons hit or are coming close to an atomic nucleus here are deflected, and this is giving a very broad spectrum of X-rays here. So this is the wavelength, short wavelengths here, long wavelengths here, and this is the intensity. So there is a bump, which depends also on the accelerating voltage. The higher the voltage, the harder the radiation. And there are also a few lines which are very characteristic of the target material, the atoms, and this is due to the fact that from a certain energy, electrons from an inner atomic shell are being emitted, and then there is a hole, and this hole is being filled by electrons from outer shells, and this energy, which is then freed, is emitted as a fluorescence photon, and this is characteristic of the material, so you get strong lines here. And what I will do now is I switch from an X-ray tube to another way to generate photons, because this is related to the lab where I come from, synchrotron radiation. And just to remind you that whenever you have an electron here and you accelerate that, for example, by moving it up and down very fast, then electromagnetic waves will be emitted. And the distribution here, so this is a dipole distribution, it goes perpendicular to the direction of movement. And the same happens when an electron is moving in a circular path very fast. Very fast means close to the speed of light. And then strange things happen. So this nice distribution here, which looks like a donut, this is a dipole, is no donut anymore, but it's strongly peaked in the direction, in the flight direction of the electron. It's a strongly peaked cone here with a very narrow opening angle when the electron is moving in a circle with almost the speed of light. So it's highly collimated, and this opening angle, for example, for our machine that we have in Hamburg is 80 microradian, or if you are more familiar with degrees, it's 0.005 degrees. This is a very narrow beam. It's much narrower than the laser pointer here. I will show you later. And in practice, that means in order to generate this light, we build large particle accelerators, and then the electrons are moving in a circular motion around the ring. And this is a typical schematic of how such a facility works. So in the middle, so this is the ring. So the electrons are circulating in this ring with constant energy and constant number, and they are generated here with a cathode, then pre-accelerated in this linear path, and then there is another ring here, which is used to bring them up to their final energy they need in this ring, and here they are stored. So the light sources are actually no synchrotrons, but storage rings. But the name comes for historic reasons. And whenever there is a curvature here, the electron is accelerated. So when the electron motion deviates from the state path, this means an acceleration. So in every part where we have a magnet, which keeps the electron on the circular path, a photon is being emitted with a very narrow cone, as I just showed you. And the current in the machine here is not a continuous current, but the electrons circle in packets. And each packet is emitting a photon whenever it's deflected. So what you get is a sequence of flashes from each magnet. And these flashes of light are then guided away from the machine in evacuated stainless steel tubes, so-called beam lines, and then at the end you have some optics here where the photon beam is being shaped, and right at the end there is an experiment which looks very different depending on what you're doing, and there is a small piece of material and the X-rays impinge on the material and you do the experiment. This is what I will cover in the rest of my talk. These machines are quite big. They range from 300 to several kilometers in circumference. And the spectrum of light that comes out is sort of continuous, but there are ways to select a narrow slice of wavelengths which you need for your experiment. And the range that can be covered by synchrotrons is very broad. It goes from the infrared to the hard X-ray range. And in the examples that would follow, I will mostly use X-rays in this range over here. And in order to get really strong light of such a machine, it's not enough to just let them circle and being bent by magnets. But in addition, we are using so-called undulators. And this is a periodic array of magnets with alternating polarity here. And when the electron moves through this structure, this is sort of wiggling or undulating. And at each deflection point, there is a flash of light. And all these flashes interfere, they add up, amplitudes add up, and at the end you get light which is n squared times intense than from a single period here. So this is a very intense beam of light. Here's a real picture of such a structure in the machine, and when you let the light through a window here into the open, you can even see the fluorescence from the ambient air. And this, the light power is quite extraordinary, just to compare the numbers here. So this is what you get from sunlight on Earth. On a square millimeter, it's 0.0013 watts. And from an undulator, it's 8,000. So this is a dramatic factor. And it even allows you to drill holes here in copper, cooled copper pipes. This is what happens when you are not aware of what you are doing. And this happened at our lab some time ago. This is not what you want to do, but it demonstrates the power of the beam. So synchrotron radiation is a very powerful light source, which gives you X-rays with extraordinary properties. And this is just a summary here. And as a takeaway message, you should memorize that it has extremely high intensity. And those of you who are familiar with X-ray lab sources, please remember that even for the most modern lab sources, they do not compare with what you get out from such a magnet device at a synchrotron. There is a factor of at least 10,000 in between. And also the radiation is strongly collimated, so the beam size here of these light flashes is about 1 millimeter on the vertical if you are 100 meters away from the source. So this is much more collimated than this laser pointer here. And you can see this brilliance of the light. Brilliance is intensity and collimation and time structure over the years. This is where X-ray sources are, and then the curve goes steeply up here over many decades. And over the last years, and there is an increase of about a factor of 10,000 per decade since 65. This is much more than Moore's law, if you compare that. Okay, so this is where I come from. So this is our X-ray light source in Hamburg. It's a big ring, 2.3 kilometers. We use these blue shaded halls to do the experiments. So all the experimental instruments that we are being used for material science investigations are inside these halls. This is a view into the tunnel, which you normally don't see because it's closed. And I will show you a couple of experiments with these highly intense X-rays because they are an excellent probe for the study of material properties. And I will show a few examples of that. And there are basically two types of experiments. One is elastic scattering of X-rays. Elastic means the X-rays don't lose any energy when they interact with material. They keep their energy, and you can do scattering in type of diffraction. You can also do imaging. This is a sketch. I will come back to some of these applications later. And the take-home message is that the X-rays interact with the atoms. They are scattered. And if you have, for example, here a periodic array of atoms in the material, then you get interferences of the scattered X-rays. It's because X-rays are waves, and they interfere from the atomic scatterers, and this gives you, at the end, structural information if you measure these interference patterns far away from the sample. And also, atoms can take away energy from the X-rays during these interactions because there is some excitation in the atom. For example, if X-rays emit an electron here in the inner atomic shell of an atom, kick it out, then energy is needed and energy is conserved. So the energy is taken away from the photon. And this is called inelastic atomic excitation. And this can be used to study, for example, elemental composition. You can study chemical bonding and, in a broader sense, the electronic structure of materials like magnetism, superconductivity, and so on. And at the end, and this is the only picture I will show about instruments, there are very special experimental stations for very different applications, and these are just to give you a glimpse of what these look like, different instruments at different stations at Petra. Okay, so let's go for the first application. And when I got this tour through the institute here, I learned that this is very much related to what you see in this room, because I learned that the roof here in the room was overpainted in the past and then rediscovered later. It now looks very nice. And in fact, X-rays can also be used to uncover artist's work, which has been done at our facility some time ago. Namely, this is an artist work covered by an artist work. So what we did is we looked at a painting of Vincent van Gogh, an original, which we got from a museum. And it's known that Van Gogh often reused his canvases because he was always short of money. So he had finished a painting and he wanted to paint a new one. So he used lead white paint, overpainted the painting, and then painted a new one on top. And there is this famous painting here, Patch of Grass. It's about that size, 60 centimeters long or so. And looking through the painting with x-rays, an x-ray radiograph, or even by infrared reflectograph, one could see that there is a hidden structure here, which looks like a woman's head. And the idea now was, using x-rays, can we do something to uncover the hidden painting without destroying the original? Because this was something that the museum would not have been amused of. In fact, we had to insure the painting by more than 20 million euros at the time. So the idea is, why not try to study the paint chemistry by using this x-ray fluorescence radiation coming out of the material, which is characteristic of the atoms. And different paints are composed of different molecules, and the molecules are composed of different atoms. And if you look at such a spectrum here, you see different peaks here for a different wavelengths or energy or fluorescence, and they are all characteristic of the paint material. And this is what we did for the painting here. So we used a pencil beam, not too narrow, half a millimeter by half a millimeter, and very carefully raster scanned this area of the original Van Gogh painting using a focused x-ray beam. And then what you get is something that looks very interesting. So this is the original, and we scanned the area marked in red here, and if you look at this area just by taking the signal from specific atoms, so this is zinc, for example, then you see something like that. It looks pretty boring. Barium, pretty boring as well. This is lead. It's even more boring because lead, this is lead white. So he used lead white to cover his original painting. But then if you use antimony or mercury, suddenly you get the picture of a woman, even in color. And this was quite striking at the time. And in fact, we were the first one to do such type of experiments. This dates back more than 10 years. But I really use this example because I really like it. It's so nice. And now this technique is being applied all over the world in many laboratories. And if you look at the reconstructed image here and you compare that with other existing paintings of Van Gogh, there is a striking similarity here. So this was really a very nice result. And we also got some nice press coverage at the time. Okay, going to another area of imaging. So this is what many of you know, not from personal experience, but from the media, for example. This is computed tomography, where you can obtain very nice three-dimensional reconstructions of structures in the human body. What we do with synchrotron radiation is not this scale, but we do microtomography, micro CT, with highly collimated synchrotron radiation in a non-destructive way. And micro tomography means that you have a monochromatic beam of X-rays, highly collimated, you shine it through a material, and then the material is rotated and scanned through the beam, and behind the sample you have a sort of a detector, and you catch the two-dimensional image, and you take image by image by image as a function of the orientation of the sample. And then later on, using a computer, you do a 3D reconstruction of the images, and you end up with a tomogram. And using synchrotron radiation, the resolution can be from micrometer down to 10 nanometer. So this is really the end, which is being reached at the moment. So this is sort of world record 10 nanometer, and our facility is one of the few facilities where you can reach this resolution. And as an example, I show you a study on a fossil insect, which is preserved in amber, and which was studied by micro-CT. And the background is that it's known, not only from insects, but also from insects, that pheromones play a very important role in the social behavior of the insects because they have different purposes. They can be used for alarming, to mark territorial ownership, or for mating. And for a few moths, it is known that these pheromones are being produced here in an area of the wing in pocket-like structures. So this is known from living animals. And now, the question was, can we do can we learn anything by looking at fossils, which are reasonably well preserved, for example, from insects preserved in amber. And the study that I'm presenting was on a biting mosquito here in a 54-million-year-old Indian amber. And this is what people did with these micro-computed tomography, and the resolution here is about 2 by 2 micrometer squared. So this is the male mosquito, the female mosquito here, 0.0 millimeter is the scale. The entire animal here is below 1 millimeter. And if I would have shown you a nice video here, but unfortunately this is not working because of a PC and Mac incompatibility. So, but if you zoom into the picture here, you get a three. You can do specific cuts in 2D by moving slices through the body and through the wing part, and then you would see that in the right wing here, this is the part of the right wing, measured with very high resolution. This is 0.2 millimeter here. There is a similar pocket-like structure, and the conclusion is that these pheromones released in structures in the wings might already have been developed more than 50 million years ago. And this is very nice result for evolutionary biologists, for example. So this is a nice example of applications of micro-CT with this resolution in the few micrometer range. And now I will move over using the same technique, but I will move over from insects to catalysts, so it's quite a jump, but the technique is the same. And as we all know, we have this, most of us have these catalysts sitting underneath our cars, and they're working nicely, but they're not working forever because there is an aging effect, and this is really something that we should worry about because it's very expensive at the end to exchange these catalysts. So aging of an exhaust gas catalyst, this example is platinum, on alumina. Why platinum? Because typically the active parts of a catalyst are some noble metals which are deposited on some structured supports, and platinum and alumina is one of these examples. And these are the typical reactions you want to have happen in a catalyst, namely the oxidation of CO, which is nasty, to CO2, which is okay, or the reduction of NO to nitrogen, or the oxidation of hydrocarbons here. So all these reactions usually happen in these catalysts containing noble metals, but there is an aging effect. So this is an example here where such a catalyst has been heated in air for some time, and you see here temperature, and this is the carbon monoxide conversion efficiency in percent, and there is an aging going on after some time, so it takes after some time, a higher temperature to get to the same conversion ratio. And now the question is, can we learn anything about the mechanism by looking at the catalyst with tomography with a resolution of 1 micrometer? And the answer is, of course, yes, because when you really resolve the fine structures of the active areas of the catalyst, then you see that the fresh part here looks completely different from the aged part at high temperatures after 24 hours. And what you see is these red blobs, and these are the initially nanometer-sized platinum particles. After some time, grow into larger crystals. These are the red blobs here, and they agglomerate preferentially in voids here between the support grains, and this is degrading the efficiency of the catalyst. So this is also a nice way to see on a micrometer scale into the microcosm and learn why this catalyst is aging. And in the next example, I stay with aging catalysts and look at the conversion of, let's say, industrial scale fluid catalytic cracking. And this is used by for conversion of high boiling parts of crude oil into what we all need, which is petrol, low boiling parts. And catalysts which are able to do this are usually zeolites. So this is a typical catalyst particle, and you see the scale here. This is 10 micrometers, so this is about 100 micrometer or so. And now using a slightly different technique, but also a tomography technique of one of these H particles, the hope is that we would learn why this catalytic zeolite particles lose their efficiency in the catalytic process. And here we combine what is called an X-ray typography technique with X-ray fluorescence imaging. X-ray fluorescence we have used also for the painting. Now we use it for a catalyst particle. And X-ray typography is a little bit different from the usual typography. And without going into details, it's simply scanning a sample here in a very narrow beam. So you have a narrow beam and you scan the sample and take images at each position laterally, and the images overlap a little bit. And then at the end, you do a computational reconstruction of all these full field images, where I should mention the light that they use for this has coherent properties. I will not tell you why this is needed, but you have to believe me that the light has to be coherent in order to do all the reconstruction. And then at the end, you get also down to fine details of this particle, not only the structure, but also the chemistry, because at the same point, you're looking at the fluorescence, which gives you elemental information, same as for the painting. And here we have a data challenge, because this is a recent experiment. When you do this experiment, the field of view, this is the area that you scan, is 100 by 100 micrometer. The beam size is 300 by 300 nanometer, so our beams get smaller now. And usually for this experiment, they have done 130,000 spectra or diffraction patterns per projection and 178 projections, and this gives you 3 terabyte per tomogram. So this easily fills a modern hard disk. And if you do many of these experiments, you really have to worry what about to do with your data. It's not only storage, but later on you have to handle the data. And this is one of the biggest challenges that we have in this modern synchrotron applied research at the moment. How to handle these huge amounts of data which the modern detectors give us. And unfortunately, this is another video that does not work, so I have to tell you in principle what you would have seen here. At least you get a still picture. So this is a tomographic reconstruction of these particles. You see the length scale here. And the resolution for the element distribution is 300 nanometer in this picture, so it's way better than the resolution I've shown you before. And the structural data obtained by this typography technique is even better. It's below 100 nanometers. So we are really going down into the atomic regime here. And unfortunately, the movie is not working, but you see the colored rim here, and this is iron and nickel, and using the tomogram, you can show that the entire particle is covered at the outer rim by iron and nickel particles. And this is the finding of the experiment. So the metal residuals, which are nickel and iron here, poison the catalyst because they cover the particle and inhibit the transport of the catalytic reactants into the particle, which is needed for the catalysis. So this is causing the aging process. Okay, and now still another catalyst, but now we go to the atomic scale. So we look at a catalyst and do this at the atomic scale. And we do this with a catalyst under realistic conditions, because static catalyst is boring. So we really want to know how this thing is working and why also here different catalysts are acting differently. And this experiment, which is also done by scattering of X-rays here to get structural information. So this is somehow a cell where the catalyst is working. It's heated and there's a gas flow, and you measure what gases are going in, what gases are coming out. So you know that the catalysis is really working. And the X-rays are needed here to get the structural information on a detector here scattered from the catalyst. And you see this is a typical diffraction pattern. And the system that they studied here is CO oxidation, and this is a platinum rhodium alloy nanoparticle, which is responsible for the catalytic activity. And how do we get the structure? And this is done by X-ray diffraction. And if you look at a X-ray diffracted signal, you see that you get diffraction from, let's say, a face like that at a different angle and position than diffraction from the top face here. And why is this cartoon looking like that? So this is information which you actually get out from the experiment, not going into details here. But you can distinguish in the diffraction signal between this face here and the other faces. And this is the structure of the nanoparticle. And if you do that in detail, then you learn that the faces behave differently. So what happens is, when you let in increasingly amount of oxygen, with the red atoms here, then what happens is that a tri-layer of rhodium and two oxygen is building up on the surfaces. And when this layer is complete, then the catalytic reactivity goes down, because the oxygen that comes next will only see in oxygen and nothing happens. But at the edges here, this layer breaks up. So the edges are still catalytically active. And this is what came out from the study. So the sandwiches break up at the edges here, and this generates free sites for the catalytic activity. So what we learn is, we need particles with more edges, and then the catalytic activity will be more efficient. Okay, now I'm done with catalysis, going through all the length scales from micrometers through atomic resolution, and I will now come to another example where we make use of this highly collimated beams of X-rays that we get out from the synchrotron, and this is the study of materials under extreme conditions. And why do we need a small beam here as well? And this is due to the fact that it's not so easy to reach these extreme conditions. And why do we want to do this experiment anyhow? The question is, what do we know, what do we learn about the structure and dynamics of our planet in the interior? And if you look at the cross-section here of the Earth, then a large fraction here is made up of the lower mantle. About half the volume of the Earth is the lower mantle. And the physical and chemical properties of the lower mantle are therefore very essential for the behavior of the Earth as a whole. And if you want to study the material under these conditions, of course, you cannot drill a hole and make an experiment in the mantle. This is not working for obvious reasons. But you have to make sure that you generate similar conditions in the lab. And this is done by squeezing material under high temperatures up to very high pressures. And this can usually only be done by using a diamond anvil, because diamond is one of the hardest materials that we know. So you have two diamonds here, and in the middle is a very tiny piece of material, which you also find in the lower mantle, and then you squeeze the diamonds together and generate very, very high pressures. And the pressures that can be reached correspond to the pressures that you would have at the bottom part of the lower mantle, which is about 136 gigapascal, corresponding to 1.4 megabars. So this is a pretty high pressure. And at the same time, it's not only pressure, but the temperature is 3,000 degrees. So you need an experimental setup which is capable of reaching approximately the same conditions, and such a setup can do it. So the diamond anvil cell can be operated between 32 and 130 gigapascal, so this is this range. And by, in addition, using a laser heating with an infrared laser, you can also bring up the temperature to a range which is compatible here to the lower mantle. And the crystals in this experiment are very small. So they are about 10 by 10 times 5 cubic micrometer. And when you want to study the structure, you also need a very fine X-ray beam. And the beam used in this experiment had about the same size, 3 by 5 micrometers. So this is exactly why you need this extremely collimated X-rays, otherwise this experiment wouldn't work. And what the colleagues found here is that the study was done, I should mention, on bridgmanite. This is a magnesium ion silicon silicate aluminate. And this is the major material which the lower mantle is made of. and this corresponds to about half of the Earth's volume, so it's a very relevant material. And they studied this material under these extreme conditions, and what they found out is that first they found bridgmanite, which contained also iron here in some parts, and this is the material which they really found for the first time. It was never synthesized before. And they studied this material by looking at the X-ray diffraction, which is very sensitive to structure information, and what they found is nothing. So in principle, this is boring, but this is interesting because they could show that this compound is stable up to 120 GPa and up to 3,000 Kelvin, because really nothing changed. And this is very important, and in addition, they did measurements of the compressibility and found out that this is different from other known forms of bridgmanite, and all this information combined has some really direct implication on the interpretation of seismic data, and this is relevant for all of us. I know that you also have earthquakes here occasionally. We don't have this in Hamburg, so we don't care, but maybe you should. So this was a very interesting result from this experiment. Okay, now I leave the Earth mantle and go back to more softer materials. Before we were looked at very hard materials, now we look at soft materials. And this is something that would help us to learn from nature, namely to generate biomimetic materials from cellulose. The cellulose, as you know, are the building blocks for many bio-based materials. And the nanostructure here of the cellulose really determines their physical properties. And what the colleagues did here, they had a fluid through a very narrow capillary, and they used hydrodynamic alignment to really do the gelination of this fibers here. And the result was that they came up with filaments made of these nanofibrils, which are very hard, and the hardness is comparable to wood. So the experiments look like this. So there is a fluid flow through this capillary here, which is narrowing, and then you look at the different positions here with an X-ray beam, which is very narrow as well, a micrometer squared, and you look at the scattering, which tells you something about the orientation of these fibers, and along the fluid flow here in the narrow parts, you see that the stuff is ordering. And at the end, what comes out is a strong cellulose filament about 20 micrometer thick. Here is an electron micrograph, which is really very hard. And the narrow beam really gives you a very fine probe about this orientation here along this capillary. So this is another application where you really can make use of X-ray scattering and this very nice focused beam. I'm not sure I would, maybe I should. Another interesting thing is to look at these ordered organic lipids here on a water surface. So they have a tendency to really order in a safe assembly, and then they form an organic layer floating on the liquid here, and then you can push by with a barrier, you can squeeze this stuff together, and then strange things happen. So they reorganize and they change their shape, and what can happen is that they form this spherical vesicles, which are hollow in the middle, and vesicles in principle could be a nice vehicle to transport drugs in the human body. But the thing is that whenever you have a spherical vesicle, this is very stable. So we can put the drug inside, but it will not come out again. So this is not good for drug delivery. Would be nice to have something which is not spherical. And an experiment which was done quite recently, last year, they found out that for this lipid here, which is a very stiff lipid, it would oppose any bending, and instead of forming a spherical vesicle, it forms a cubic vesicle, looking like that. And the structure can be deduced the same way we did it before, namely by X-ray diffraction with a very narrow beam onto the surface where the lipids float on water, And then by examining the scattering pattern, you can deduce the shape of the vesicle. And what comes out is something like that. And this happens very early, also at even at small pressures. It becomes sort of crystalline. And these cubic vesicles sort of could be a nice way to deliver drugs on the body because they are not so stable. So at certain parts here in veins where the channel is narrow, they could crack open and deliver the drug where it's wanted. Okay, so coming towards the end a little bit, one of the early applications of this brilliant synchrotron radiation was to study the detailed structure of biomacromolecules, because you need this well-collimated beam, because usually biocrystals only are micrometer in size. So you need a well-collimated beam to get the detailed information on the structure. And the video you just saw, this is a diffraction pattern you would get on a detector behind such a small biocrystal. And this is a reconstructed atomic model of the crystal. And in this example here, it's the structure of the ribosome. And why I'm showing this, because Ada Jonath, she is a chemist, got the Nobel Prize 2009 for resolving the structure of the ribosome. And much of the work that she did was done in Hamburg at Doris. Not exclusively, but she was visiting Hamburg and staying there for experiments for quite some years. But she also did experiments at other labs, and everyone is showing this picture here because it's very rarely that you can show a Nobel laureate who did experiments at your lab. And now, from here, I make a very short detour towards new X-ray sources. I tell you why later, which is free electron lasers. And so far, we had electrons accelerated and stored into a ring shaped machine producing light. But there is another way to produce even more intense light, and this is by accelerating the electrons in the linear accelerator, also quite large, in our case, several kilometers. And when you pass this very well-focused electron beam through an undulator, this was this periodic magnet structure arrangement, then under some conditions, it's possible to produce laser-like pulses, which are ultra-short and very intense. You have a similar facility close by in Trieste. It's also a free electron laser, but this is not for the hard X-rays. It's a much softer machine. In Hamburg, we just got the European XFEL facility into operation last year, and this is a big machine, 3.5 kilometers long, starting at DESY, and has an experimental campus outside the city limits, by the way. And this is a very powerful source for very hard X-rays. So in principle, you can do the same experiments I've shown you before with one additional component, and this is that the pulse of the radiation coming out is much more intense and much shorter. And much shorter means that in a storage ring, this light pulse, which the electrons are emitting, is about 100 picoseconds. So this is symbolized by this bump here. And in a laser, it's below 100 femtoseconds. So this is many orders of magnitude below that. And the number of photons here, 10 to the 13 in a single pulse, roughly corresponds to what you get out at a synchrotron in 1 second. So everything is squeezed together in time to produce a very, very high spike of photons, very intense. And for those who really cannot visualize 100 femtoseconds, there is a nice example. So how short is short? So this is 100 femtoseconds. The speed of light, most of you know that, is 300,000 kilometers per second. That means it takes about 1.5 seconds from a light beam from the Earth to the Moon. And in the same time span, 100 femtosecond in the same with the same velocity, 100 femtosecond means that a beam of light would not make it through a human hair, which is 30 micron. So that's really fast. And what is it good for? This is good for studying, for example, very small crystals, which are so small that they are usually cannot be studied with synchrotron light, because the density of the light is not sufficient. The experiments would take forever. And the trick is here to use these narrow and intense pulses from an FEL and let this interact with a small particle or molecule. And you could ask, how is it possible on such a time scale to hit the particle at all? And the answer is simply by statistics. You just have a flow of particles, and you hope that at some point they will interact. And this actually works. If you have a dense sequence of light pulses, dense enough to also interact with a dense sequence of particles flowing through, then there are a few events where an X-ray beam hits a particle. So that's the good news. The bad news is the pulse is so intense that the particle will explode immediately. So it cannot be reduced. So when the pulse hits the particle, it's gone. But here, the good news is that the information that you get from the X-ray scattering from the particle can be measured before it falls apart. So, and this is because the scattering is from the electrons. This gives the X-ray diffraction, which is caught by the detector. And the atoms themselves are heavy nuclei, so it takes a little bit longer for the nuclei to realize that something has happened. So this thing will flow apart, or will explode later. And this is actually used also at the XFEL to study the structure of small crystals, and it's called serial femtosecond crystallography. So you study a flow of very small crystals which are injected through the beam here in a focused liquid jet. It looks simple here, but this is very fancy equipment. And then on the other hand, you have the intense light pulse here, and in this interaction point, at some instances, you get really a hit, and then you have detectors which are fast enough to get all the images. And later on, when you have several of these images, several terabytes as well, then you start to look at the images and to correlate the image that you see with the structure of the particle that was hit with the X-rays. So this is an elegant method to study these tiny crystals. And this is my last example. This has also recently been used for three-dimensional imaging of individual silver nanoparticles. And the nanoparticles were produced here in a cluster source, and the sizes of the particles were just a few tens of nanometers, so this is really small. And the X-ray beam crossing here, the flow of nanoparticles were made up of pulses of 100 femtoseconds, and then with a detector, you get the scattering image, and the typical scattering images, typical scattering images are shown here, so they look very fancy, and they have very a structure which looks a little bit unusual, and this is because the radiation is really coherent. So what you see there is a coherent scattering of the X-rays, and there is a lot of information here in these structures, and you can actually use mathematical procedures to reconstruct, not from one, but from many of these patterns, the the 3D shape of the particle. And by doing this, they discovered numerous highly symmetrical three-dimensional shapes, and there are some shapes which are known as Platonic and Archimedean bodies. If you want to know what that is, you have to look it up. I have to look it up myself, because this was not it. But it looks fancy. It sounds fancy. So this is my last example, and I showed a lot of imaging applications. And at the end, I will give you a brief summary of everything I have not been talking about, because the range of applications of synchrotron radiation is really huge in material science. I have shown chemistry and catalysis, so I will skip that. And there is a lot of things which are relevant to energy in general, which is, for example, storage. So a lot of research is done on batteries. So batteries, how do lithium-ion batteries or sodium-ion batteries? So this is a very active field of research. And synchrotron radiation, especially combined with spectroscopy techniques, really give you a clue on how these batteries are really working on the atomic level. And the same is true for sensors, storage devices, for modern IT technology. So there are very, very complex nano-layered structures of devices which have intriguing properties. And all these properties are correlated with these nano-layers being put together, because all the physics is going on at the interfaces. And this is a very narrow range of just a nanometer or below. And you need these tools which are provided by synchrotron radiation to learn how, for example, the electronic properties really relate to the structure at these interfaces. And I've shown an example here from earth science, and I've shown an example from health science. And there are other engineering-related applications as well. For example, to produce lightweight structures of materials. And also here, you need, for example, tomographic methods to really know what is the structure of these lightweight materials on the microscopic scale. And of course, this is a PR slide, you have noticed, right? Because, so there's a lot you can do with synchrotron X-ray techniques to understand the complexity of materials. And what I've shown you was just a very, very tiny part, mostly related to imaging, but imaging is not all. There is a huge area of spectroscopy, and I haven't shown a single example here. So this could be another presentation given by Itzhak, for example. So thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much for a really nice overview of this great machines that opened the view into atomic world. So first, questions maybe, the audience, if you have any questions, please. Yeah, microphone, it's coming.
I have one question about catalyst reactions. So can you see like complex reactions on a catalytic surface? Like how they orient and which molecule absorbs by another, and like to verify DFT studies and so on.
So the answer is, in principle, yes, but we are not quite there yet. But there is a clear tendency that many of the most recent sophisticated experiments go exactly in this direction. So we might have to wait a little bit of I don't know, a year or so, but the development is really very fast. So the answer is yes, at some point we should be able to do that.
Thank you.
Okay. Another question? Maybe in between, I should ask one thing. I remember when we started, our group started, we came to your beamline, 88, 89, I guess, with Professor Codre. At that time, we were working on the old machine, which was used for particle physics. So we had this nice beam only when they didn't measure, really. And then they crashed the electrons and positrons together, and we lost the beam. So we had to wait another time. So, but from that time, now the whole DESI really changed the direction. And now you, at some point, you decided to be focused on photon science. So when and why decided really this was a really change in direction, scientific direction completely of DESI?
Yeah, this was really twofold. So one reason is that the particle physics program, which sort of was the major activity at DESI for decades, sort of came to an end in 2007. Because the particle accelerator that we had for this type of experiments was simply too small. So these activities moved to CERN, and these colleagues are now using the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider, to continue their work. And then, on the other hand, the photon science community needed a brighter machine. And Petra 2, which at the time was used for the big particle collider simply as a pre-accelerator, was the ideal machine to be used as a light source. So there was a decision to convert this big ring, 2.3 kilometers, into a dedicated X-ray source. And all the results I've shown here, most of the results were done at the new source.
Well, and immediately after that, there's a tricky question, of course. You built a lot of new machines. Where did you get the money? Because I've seen that also now when this machine is, let's say, operating nicely, you already have a plan for Petra 4 yes. in 24, which will completely reconstruct the right. existing one to get even brighter source. Right. But then you need really a big support yeah. to get such infrastructure.
Yeah, all these investments are way too large to be handled by DESY alone. So we are currently preparing a proposal for the next generation of machines, Petra 4, as you said. And this will be the ultimate light source for this type of investigations. So it will provide an extremely collimated beam, not only in the vertical, but also in the horizontal. And then you could do many of these techniques at really nanometer level, which is not possible at the moment. And of course, we need money from our government. This is very simple.
So we have to government.
We have to write down, come up with a very convincing science case, which I believe we have. And then we have to be confident that politics also agrees with us that this is a good investment into future technologies and science to give us the money to build the new machine.
Okay, maybe another question from audience. Is there anything else? Please.
I stopped working on the synchrotron with the generation 2, I believe it was in Wisconsin. Ooh. And then the undulators came and the free electron lasers. Can you spare some words where the development in the synchrotron radiation is going on now? You mentioned something, shorter pulses, attosecond pulses, and nano-size beams. Is there anything else?
That's a very good question, because we were used in the past that every new source would give an increase of, I don't know, a number of 10 or so in intensity. But this is clearly no longer the case. So the intensity, which is the number of total photons you're getting out, is more or less the same. There may be an increase of a factor of 2 or so. So what has happened in the recent past is that there was a lot of development into detectors, which was really needed. Because in the past, when we started to work together, these detectors, which deliver these nice results, were not available. So we could not even dream about these type of detectors. But this has now been done, so you're getting a huge amount of data and practically no photons are lost because detectors are very effective. What will happen next is that you really try to squeeze down the beam size to a few nanometers in all directions. And this requires the development of new machines because the current machines simply cannot do this. And for the specialists, so the keyword here is diffraction limit. So we really want to build a diffraction limited X-ray source at 1 angstrom. So this is what the Petra 4 project is about. And the applications really are similar to what I've shown here, but focused, all the applications can be done on a nanometer level, and this cannot be done with the present machines.
Okay. If there are any more questions. So let's thank the speaker again for this nice talk. Thank you.